All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it bringing it all down here on the West Coast. Man, happy spring. It's June. There's some crazy stuff to talk about. This week has been wild. Kind of let some stories kind of pile up to all talk about in one video. And so here we are. So again, this channel for the most part focuses on football, because that's for the most part everybody's favorite sport. But, you know, I like to hit on everything. It is originally Sports Chat. The original inception of the show was definitely to talk about all sports. I do watch all sports, including hockey and everything else. But we're here to talk about the Ducks first and foremost. We have a bunch of different stuff to talk about, okay? Will Richardson comes back. Phil Knight puts an offer on the Blazers, which is huge. Celtics win game one of the finals. Peyton has a good game. There's some connections there. And then just some other random stories out there in college football, in the landscape. Let's go ahead and jump into Will Richardson first and foremost. Will coming back is absolutely huge. Just speaking on him personally, this is a guy that is a very big guard. He is a flexible guard. He can be a point guard. He can be a shooting guard. He's been consistent. He had a tough end of the year last year after he got sick with mono. But the guy is an absolute gamer. He's pretty quiet on the court. He does let his game do his talking. He tends to come up big in the biggest games. Even when he's not that productive scoring the ball, he definitely gets people involved with assists and everything else. He's big guard. So if you want to run with the big guard lineup, he's a really nice guy to have in that lineup. With the transfers coming in and with the new class coming in, recruiting class, point guard room is pretty stacked right now. And so I think Dana's going to run some two-guard sets where you see both guards the lineup at the same time, like you saw with Will and Davion Harmon last year. I really like Will's ability to play off of another guard. I think he's really nice to get good rebounds. He can put kind of people into the corner a little bit and shake and bake and kind of stretch the floor a little bit, even in the half court set, by having a separate point guard on the floor at the same time. It's kind of nice to be able to kind of separate that. They do like to run the dribble handoff at the top of the key. That play is basically called Oregon across the whole AAU circuit. And that dribble handoff is very productive for a guy like Will, because he's looking for either a mismatch or he's looking for a guy coming off of that with maybe his on his heels a little bit. He can kind of shake and bake, get to the rim. He's such a big guard at 6'5" that he can do a lot around the rim. He's very productive. The guy, when he comes out and plays the way he wants to play, he can really set the tone. And that's, I think, what was missing last year with Dana's team, was you didn't really have a killer down the stretch. You lost your best player down the stretch, which was Will Richardson. So to be able to have him come back this year is a really big deal. I do think it says something also about NIL potential. I think it also has something around the lens of that there's going to be more money a little bit in the pot this year to share. And that might be enticing for him. He does get the extra year. He's played 4 years, but because of COVID, he's got the extra year, so why not use it? Especially in the NBA, when you have such a very difficult window to be able to get in. There's a lot of guys who are skilled, 6'5", go around to all the different 24-hour fitness type gyms anywhere around the country, and you'll find them on the noon runs. There's dudes who can absolutely fly, great up and down game, really strong handles, really strong, but you know, they just for whatever reason missed their opportunity. They didn't want to go play Europe, or they did play Europe for a little bit and struck out. I think Will could play tomorrow in Europe, but I think he's really set on an NBA career. And you know, maybe he has a potential, but he's got to get better defensively, and he's got to be a better shooter. The way the NBA is gone right now, with everything being stretched out so far, you either have to get the ball on the floor to the rim, which he can do, or you're going to have to be able to stretch people out with the three. Now, he can shoot the ball deep, and he's proven that. He's proven that he's been a good shooter, but I think he has to have more confidence in that going forward to really make a difference on the next level. But really stoked that Will's coming back. He's a leader. He's the best player on the team when he's playing well. And this next year, they're going to really need him. I think going into this next year, you know, having a transfer and having a basically a freshman being the two guys that looking at to be a point guard, you know, having Will come on that team and come back to a natural spot that's basically already his, you know, it might be a little difficult for Dana to find time for some of these guys and find minutes for him. But at this point in the game, Will's the better option. Everybody knows that. So I really like that move. Let's talk about Phil Knight. Wow. Uncle Phil possibly owning an NBA team. This could be huge. One, we're out here in Portland, small market team. We saw what happened to Seattle. Seattle's twice the size of Portland. You know, this is a tough situation, right? Having Paul Allen gave Portland and the Seattle Seahawks, by the way, one of the richest owners in the game, and it really gave them a lot of flexibility. They spent a lot of money on teams. They were always, for the most part, competitive. The Seahawks, obviously, were much better than the Blazers ever were, winning Super Bowls. But, you know, the Blazers were competitive. Every year, they definitely threw money around. They were heavy in the luxury tax. Since his passing, which is now almost 4 years ago, now it seems like, I think it was 2017, but, you know, now he's in a position where the trust, they're going to have to sell the team at some point. It was a part of the deal. There's no time frame set on the sale, but Paul Allen said in the trust that his sister, Jody Allen, who's running the thing right now, and Burt Cole, his buddy, are going to have to sell it at some point, and the Seahawks. The goal, though, is to find a local buyer. Now, there's not that many billionaires rolling around that want to put their money in these teams. Now, there is a good return on investment on these teams. You've seen the value of these teams skyrocket over time. But the day-to-day operations is a pretty heavy number that you're going to have to clear. And so there's a lot of people who kind of want it for, you know, ego's sake, like maybe the Mark Cuban type who wants to really be the front and center guy, wants it to be his baby, wants to be on the sideline, wants to be on the bench, wants to be in the team playing, you know, kind of be that guy. And then there's the guys who, you know, that you never even see. They're not even in the box. Maybe they are if they go to the finals or something like that. But, you know, you don't even see the owner. And, you know, Paul Allen seemed to be kind of somewhere in the middle. He was very prevalent. He was there. You could see him. You could see him at any game you wanted to see him at. But he, you know, was not that loud of a presence. And I think Phil would be very similar. I think Phil would not be a loudmouth owner by any stretch. I think he would be very well taken care of. It's a joint venture, him and a partial owner of the Dodgers, Alan Selimski. But I think Phil, you know, is the main guy here, right? I think the way that he would run the Blazers would be really unique. You know, he's seen it from a unique perspective. He's from here. His company was started before the Blazers, or right around that same time. The Blazers started in 70, Nike started in 72, so that's my bad. But within the first couple 3 years, you know, definitely has seen the rise of that sport and been a part of that rise with Nike working with the NBA. I think it'd be a unique perspective. I think it'd be a win-win for the NBA. I think the NBA would actually appreciate that more than probably anybody else. But it would be interesting with all the Nike branding and everything. I do think there would be kind of a little bit of a conflict of interest, it feels like. But Phil's, for the most part, out of the Nike situation. He's now just on his own deal. He still represents, obviously, Nike, and obviously represents his donations to the U of O and everything else that goes along with that. And his philanthropy everywhere else, too. I mean, this guy gives a lot of money away to a lot of different organizations. But being a part of the NBA franchise, that'd be a pretty cool situation. It'd be pretty cool for Portland as well. And going forward, I don't know exactly where that would go in the future when Phil passes, but it would be a nice situation to kind of have him in the loop for at least a while and let him enjoy that. But his bid was for $2 billion. They, I guess, want $3 billion, even though it's basically all, projected right now. The value of it is projected right around $2 billion. But I think that'd be fantastic from a Portland perspective to have, obviously, somebody who's not going anywhere jump in on that. The question mark on that is the L.A. side of it, real estate developer, who, you know, Selimski is, you know, again, this is a guy who owns part of the Dodgers. And, you know, it might be well in his interest to just hang on to the Blazers and make it a deal there. The fan base in Portland is absolutely phenomenal. When you go around the country, Portland fan base is tremendous. They're in a pretty good building. It is older comparatively to some of the other buildings, but it was built so futuristic that it really has held up well and aged well. But it definitely needs work. So, again, pretty interesting stuff. Let's talk about the finals. I love the NBA finals. I'm a big basketball fan. I watch a lot of hoop all year long. That's a sport that I coached the longest, so I kind of see it from the perspective of a coach the most, even though I try to break down all the sports from the coach's perspective. Basketball is the one I feel like I see the best in time, and I can kind of feel when teams are going on a run or not, or where it's going to happen, and just for, again, for coach's perspective, been around the game a long time. So going into this series, I was kind of split, right? I was like, well, you know, if the Celtics defense shows up at the right time, the Celtics are going to be really in it, you know? If the Golden State Warriors do what they do and just start pouring it on, you know, there's not much you can do with that. So it's all about kind of how the Celtics score outside of Tatum, and obviously how the Warriors score outside of Curry. And if you can get other guys involved and other guys start to produce, then you've got a series, right? And what happened in that first game was just so awesome. I watched the first game live, and then I rewatched the fourth quarter, end of the third, beginning of the, and the whole fourth quarter, just to kind of see it again, and slow it down, rewind some stuff, and kind of watch it with a little bit more analytical eye. And you know, it was really interesting because the Warriors were never really out of it until basically the last, like, 2 minutes. You know, that's a team that can score at will, and it's just about whether they can rebound. I think rebounding has always been the number one thing. If you give a team a second chance, you know you're in trouble, especially in the NBA, because the chances of a team making a shot, you know, go up dramatically if they get a second opportunity at it, right? So if you go down and get a stop, they miss shot, you get a rebound, you go down and clear, you go down to the other side, you're in a much, much better win trajectory than if you are just letting them hang around on their side, right? And I feel like the Celtics were really, really rebounding the ball well. So Golden State's got to rebound better. If Golden State can rebound better, I don't know if the Celtics are going to be able to score with Golden State. I definitely don't think the Celtics are going to have that kind of a outpour like you had in the fourth quarter, scoring 40 points in the fourth, having Al Horford hit six threes. I mean, there was so much going on in that game. There were three or four guys that had 20 points, it felt like. But, you know, I obviously, as a Duck fan out here, I'm looking at it from the Peyton Pritchard perspective. Peyton had a great game. Again, you know, a guy that fills in, does what he does. You know, he looks for his time, gets his minutes. Ime Udoka, a guy who's my age, absolute legend here in Portland. You know, I think knows how to use him a little bit and puts him in crunch situations and really clutch times in the fourth quarter. He was getting quality minutes. Marcus Smart coming off of an injury helps a little bit. They want to limit his minutes a little bit. But Peyton's such a good plus-minus guy. You know, he goes in there. First thing he does, gets a nice rebound. He gets an assist. He goes over, you know, he gets a bucket. Then they kick it back out to him. He gets a three, you know. There's all these kind of different angles for him to be able to produce. And it's not just scoring the ball. It's passing. It's rebounding. He does a really good job clearing glass and pushing the tempo. He does a really good job of getting to the next player in transition, pushing the ball down the court. There's plenty of times where he was getting an assist basically because he was just making the best basketball play, which is just moving the ball one more rotation to the open man. And they just were so on fire that he was picking up a lot of assists just on the fact that the Celtics were just doing so well, right? So gotta love Peyton. Gotta love what he's doing out there. I'm so happy and so proud for him to be able to be in the situation he's in. Podium player on the first night, pretty cool. And just the idea that he kind of fits in so well with Boston, you know, being that undersized guy, being the white guy, being the Portland, you know, guy is somebody who we always appreciate. But, you know, I think there's also a lot to be made of that storyline in Boston, right? I think that storyline says something to be said about that. Not to get racial or whatever, but I know for a fact that there are Boston media people, I've seen it all on Twitter and everything else, that they do appreciate him on a variety of levels. And I think just his hard work and his ethics, you know, they talk about how, you know, when he was at Oregon, sometimes he would get mistaken as one of the managers. You know, he's one of these kind of guys. He's like, I'll let my play do the talking. You'll know who I am at the end of the game, you know. Classic Peyton. And then, you know, just stuff around like the money. You know, Ryan Day came out and said he's going to need, Ohio State's going to need about $13 million a year to cover the NIL. And, you know, just to kind of think about just kind of putting more numbers into the, into the conversation, putting more money into the equation, and constantly pushing that envelope of becoming more and more and more of a professional sport. You know, I definitely see it coming. We've talked about it here a couple times. I've definitely been talking about it on the other shows that I've been on. You know, the trend is moving toward the college football not even being a part of the NCAA, college football doing it completely its own thing, generating its own income, striking its own TV deals, not having the regulations of the NCAA. And, you know, a school like Ohio State that's basically been on top and been, what, however they've been able to manipulate the system, they've been able to do it, whether it's been legal, illegal, positive, negative, whatever the case may be. Kudos to them. They've done a hell of a job. We know it's a football factory, and we know they've been a great and a hotbed. Ohio's a hotbed of football. The Midwest, a hotbed of football, and they have always had that tradition. I'm not saying they're cheating or anything, but I'm saying is that if they have been paying players, they've been paying players, right? So the idea of $13 million a year, I think, is a number that maybe might not sit that well with a lot of people thinking about that number trending forward and trending upward as it goes. And it's just a conversation to have right now around, like, how much is it worth and how much will it then impact the rest of the college football landscape? How will it affect ticket prices? How will it affect merch sales? How will it affect tuition sales? How will it affect all these other kind of things, you know, when, you know, so much money is going to be needed to go in and fuel these programs? Now, there's a lot of money to be made here. I know there's already that. These schools are making a lot of money as is. But, you know, to say to be able to stay competitive, that they're going to need to have and clear a certain number that's in the millions, tens of millions now on year one, what's it going to be going in the future? So just an interesting conversation to have. I thought that was a wild one to hear. All right, guys, thank you for watching Sports Chat 503. We will talk here soon, everybody. Adios.